there's no one cause which can create effects. Everything is always that arises, always comes about through interaction. But that interaction is we can describe it, we look at things more analytically, you can see that in any given kind of situation, there's one dominant cause, key cause, one might say, surrounded by conditions, the conditions which make it possible for that cause to, as it were, to the potential in that cause to produce something to be unlocked. So like, you know, the analogy from gardening, your seed needs the conditions around it of water and so on. So the seed has all the potential to manifest as an oak tree, but it can't do so without the conditions. So analogy is from one perspective, although of course the depends how deep the perspective goes, but from a kind of ordinary perspective, that kind of sums up the relationship between the mind and the body, the mind and the nervous system, the mind and the brain. The mind itself is that which is capable of consciousness, that which is capable of sentience. Physical things are not capable of that because they're material, they're not endowed with sentience. The mind is formless and has consciousness. But in this life, without the cooperating conditions of the nervous system, the mind can't encounter anything. Your mind could not see, your mind cannot see the door, cannot see the sunlight without the eye faculty, and the eye faculty connected, plugged into the central nervous system. The central nervous system itself is just an agglomeration of matter, no matter how complex, cannot be conscious, but it makes it possible for the consciousness to perceive and interact with the external world. So from an initial point of view, the relationship is one of chief cause and cooperating conditions which interact. And that works very well when simply that count is very good because it defines the, depends upon defining the essential characteristics of these two different aspects of the world: consciousness, formless and but sentient, and matter, made of form, limited and not endowed with sentience. Chemicals, no matter how long you leave them, do not become sentient. Electricity, no matter how strong it is, how strong the pulse is, cannot become sentient. But these can act as cooperating conditions for consciousness to manifest in a particular form, in a particular way, in a particular interaction with the world. Now, if one then, as it were, examines that interaction more profoundly, as it's examined in the mind-only system of tenets of the philosophical school within Mahayana teaching or Madhyamaka, we'll actually see that, in fact, there are no intrinsically existent phenomena whatsoever. That the idea that there's a mind on one side and physical things on the other, and somehow they interact, that is like a provisional picture, a provisional reading. Really, in fact, of course, there cannot be any interaction between these things. There's just a flow of mental experience. Because if mind existed on one side and physical things existed on the other, how would there be any interaction between the two? Because they would have utterly different natures, and there would have to be a gap between them, which would mean there'd be like one side one thing on one mountain and the other another thing on another mountain. But that's not the way we experience. When we experience a seamless continuity. Later on, when we add language to it and try to think about what it was, then we may say, oh, there's my mind here seeing an external world there. But in the actual immediacy of experience, there's no such duality. There's no such gap. So in other words, duality, the mind versus body, is a mistaken, although an understandably mistaken, misinterpretation of the world. So from a profound Mahayana point of view, that's how it really is. The mind-only school emphasized that unity by saying everything's merely mental experience. But of course the Madhyamakas, the middle way proponents like Nagarjuna and Harideva, who are just a tiny bit sharper in their analysis, following Buddha's teaching, the perfection of wisdom, say it makes no sense finally to say even mental, unless you already, because if there's no physical phenomena at all, then what would mental be? So that is a Madhyamaka point of view, which refuses to even use words like mind and body. It's a more profound analysis. So from a point of view of the simpler Buddhist schools of tenets, the Vaibhashika and the Sautrantika, the world is the interaction of mind and matter, moments of consciousness with continually rising atoms. But from this profound point of view, there's no two categories of mind and body. So that's it, yeah. So do you see, one has to, in order to make sense of this, one has to, in a way, analyze very carefully exactly what is being taught in Buddhism. So, for instance, Buddhism is not teaching that there's a soul which is somehow like hopping from body to body, as if I will be reborn as a bat in the next life, and there'll be a little me, a homunculus, inside that bat, a human being trapped in a bat, like Vincent Price trapped in the fly. It's not like that. Consciousness is formless. Driven by the imprints of karma, it connects, it resonates with particular circumstances, and therefore one ends up with the phenomena of rebirth. But finally, it's not like there's a self being transmitted from body, hopping from body to body. Everything is flowing interaction. I guess the younger people out there won't even remember who Vincent Price was, but I've got to tell you, he was terrifying.